is about some Palaeolithic sites located in northern Italy. They are very classical sites. They were excavated starting from the 19th century, but geochemical data were never collected from these sites. This is a PhD project, and Maurizio Zambaldi is the person who will develop this PhD project. So, Maurizio Zambaldi will talk. Thank you very much.
Okay. So, thank you to Diego for this incredible introduction. Okay, so thank you again to Diego for this incredible introduction and to everybody that organized the conference. So, as Diego said, this talk is about one of Monte Fenera prehistoric sites that is called Ciota Ciara Cave. The excavation here at the site resumed in 2009 and are led by a team of the University of Ferrara and are still ongoing. We will refer here in particular to the geoarchaeological study, a preliminary one of this cave, a work that we started from scratch and which is now still in progress as a part of my PhD research that, among its aims, is also the one to review some other studies that have been made about, or better, on prehistoric sites during the 19th century, but are still lacking in geoarchaeological data. So, first of all, where is Monte Fenera? Monte Fenera is situated in Italy, at the southern border of Western Alps in Piedmont region. We can see here in the area of Vercelli, near the city of Borgo Sesia. It is a low, mostly carbonate-built hill, that is situated at 899 meters above the sea level, hosting several paleontological and archaeological sites, among them karstic caves bearing evidence of Palaeolithic occupation. And this is the reason why Monte Fenera is relevant to us. Monte Fenera sites have a long history within the Alpine archaeology and covers a chronology that goes from prehistory to late antiquity. The sites have been extensively explored since 19th century with surveys and fieldwork that led to the discovery of several caves in which archaeological material was buried. Among all, we have to cite Ciotarun, Belvedere Shelter, that is the one that you can see in the picture, Ciota Ciara Cave, of course, and Grotta del Laghetto, Laghetto Cave in Italy. For example, in this last photo in here, we can see also inhumation, a sepulture of the late, dated to the late antiquity that was discovered in 2015. And here above, three teeth that were attributed to Neanderthals and that were found in Ciota Ciara and in Ciotarun during the 90s. So what is left now at Monte Fenera after all these years of work? Well, nowadays, not much is left, but despite the extensive archaeological fieldwork undertaken at all the Monte Fenera sites, excavation data are often missing, even for the 20th century campaign. Information on stratigraphy, chronology, formation, function remains incomplete or even lacking. Nonetheless, being among the few Palaeolithic cave sites prior to the last glacial maximum in the area, their systematic study is crucial for understanding human peopling and environmental evolution at the southern Alpine region in the Pleistocene. So what we did in Monte Fenera is to resume the investigations by reopening new excavation sectors and digging new ones. The latter are excavated by the state-of-the-art archaeological methods and are studied through an interdisciplinary approach. This includes, of course, geoarchaeological approach with the, in order to understand, as we said before, formation, assemblage integrity, scene and post-depositional processes that affected the site. We have to say that, almost as usual, geoarchaeologists were called at the site when some context have already been removed, partially or totally, and archaeologists could not sort out some specific questions on the site, leaving to us the difficult task to deal with it. Let's now introduce the site itself. Ciota Ciara is a complex, active karstic cave modeled in Triassic dolostone. It opens on west slope of Monte Fenera at an altitude of 675 meters above the sea level, and it develops for more than 200 meters. Archaeological fieldwork here, as I told before, resumed in 2009 by the work of a team led by the University of Ferrara, but they started really during the 60s with a lot of interruptions. Systematic excavation led to the discovery of an archaeological assemblage that consists of a large number of fauna remains, mainly attributed to cave bear and typical Middle Paleolithic lithic assemblage. To this are also associated possible fire features, but unfortunately they were excavated before our intervention, so we don't know anything about them. As I introduced it before, in 1989, two human feet were found. They were attributed to Homo neanderthalensis because of the site chronology and not on the ground of osteological studies. Then they can be part of those human remains that change attribution according to the age of the site where they have been found. For what concerns the chronology, according to the published data, the site would date to from MIS-5 in a temperate, humid climatic context. But we will see later that maybe this attribution would be put under discussion. The actual excavation area, the current excavation area, is located at the cave entrance, at the actual cave entrance, and covers a surface of 9 square meters. And this is still under excavation. What we have done there, it was to apply a classical geoarchaeological approach. So we have to remind that not reliable documentation or data on previous works, the one that I told that has been done during the 19th century, was available. We have thus to set our intervention from scratch, through the participation to the fieldwork and the excavation, accurate file description and subsequent sampling for routine analysis, so sedimentological analysis, basic geochemical characterization, and the micromorphological observation. All the recognized units were systematically sampled. 22 bulk samples were collected from the site and its immediate surroundings, 18 of them from profiles exposed at the site during the excavation between 2009 to 2016, in order to perform the sedimentological routine analysis. In the field, 5 stratigraphic units were defined and furtherly subdivided into subunits. Yes, you can see. Most units are sandy-silt with common to many stones, badly sorted, massive, and show chaotic arrangement and fabric. Thin layers of well-sorted fine sand also occurs, and concentration of iron and manganese oxides are common. Phosphatic rings and clay coatings are detected in almost units. Unit 14 is particularly rich in archaeological finds, while Unit 15 is a deposit of breccia, but still archaeological relevant. Unit 16 has the same characteristics of the 15, but is archaeologically sterile and rests on cave bedrock. Now let's talk a bit about the laboratory analysis and about the grain size analysis results. These show that all the units are composed of poorly sorted sandy silt or silty loam sediment. 2 grain sizes distributions were detected, although quite similar between them. The coarser fraction is mainly composed of local dolostone fragments and of few sandstone fragments. The latter, these ones, the sandstone fragments, probably come from the geological formation outcropping the Monte Fenera summit and were embedded in the sediment because of the karstic water circulation. Loss on ignition and calcimetry, okay, and analysis. So loss on ignition analysis indicates the presence of limited amounts of organic matter, while and calcimetry shows a limited content of calcium carbonate that mostly results from the dissolution of the dolomia. In addition to this sedimentary characterization, we try to show here some preliminary basic analysis about geochemical data that we obtained with XRF and XRD techniques. In particular, we can see above the element concentration of selected samples taken from the different layers, and below the XRD diffractogram of one sample taken from the unit 14. From this data, it is clear the presence of quartz, dolomite, calcite, and feldspars, which characterize the whole sedimentary succession and which are also detected under the microscope. Talking about this, 8 samples for soil micromorphology, for soil micromorphological observation were collected from the profiles described in the excavation area. Units 13 and 14 and 15 and their internal features have been systematically sampled. On the contrary, unit 16 and 103, that is in a negative interface that cuts unit 13 and 14 in the western profile, for these units it was not possible to take micromorphological samples because of the characteristics of the sediment itself. So let's see a bit of the microscopic characteristics of these units, and in particular we start with unit 13 that is characterized by a complex heterogeneous not organized silty clay groundmass. Occasionally also tractive levels are observed, like the ones we can see in the photos. Among the coarse constituents, bone fragments, often coated with manganese, are present, and also short fragments of natural origin. This one is the spongolite, that is common in an area of 500 kilometers around the site, and occasionally also small fragments of charcoal of vegetal origin. Unit 14 has a more complex structure that can be divided in distinct subunits and show a variability between not organized structures, almost a pedal, and more organized ones. The coarse fraction is characterized by feldspars, quartz, micas, but also carbonate rock fragments from the local substrate, like the one we can see in the bottom of the photo. Fragments of burnt bones are observed in these units, in unit 14, as a result of human occupation. As we told before, also a badly preserved earth has been discovered in 2013. Local chert is common in all the units, and in the last two photos we can observe an example of a so-called ciottoletto esotico, in Italian, a term that marks all the bibliography of the 19th century regarding Monte Fenera. They are mafic or ultramafic rocks that are present in the sediment because of the karstic circulation. These dissections are obviously under observation. So in this photo, I just want to show an example of the reconstruction of the stratigraphy that we are doing, and then of the formation processes of the features, of the pedo features on this void. In particular, we can recognize first a dusty clay coating and successive coarse illuvium that have been covered by a silty clay coating. The void was later filled by loose discontinuous infilling of residual sands deriving from the disintegration of the dolomia of the walls. Unit 15 is characterized by heterogeneous, not organized sandy silt groundmass with chert fragments and, like the one we can see here, clay pebbles and bone fragments that are strongly coated by manganese oxides. However, the most relevant feature in these units is the evidence of frost action that is clearly visible in the form of cappings on rocks and mineral grains, and poorly visible in the form of ice lensing, like in the last two photos. a relevant issue for this context regard the uneven occurrence of manganese oxide coatings on bone fragments. As part of the micromorphological study, a total estimation of the number of the bone fragments have been made, as well of the present distribution and development of manganese oxide beta features on bones. But I didn't reach a conclusion for the moment, so I would like to discuss my thin section during the workshops planned for the next days. Then suggestion there will be welcome. So just to arrive to the conclusion at this point, considering the results that we obtain, we can try to give some new clues on the site formation processes. So first, the data indicate that the deposit filling Ciota Ciara entrance was mostly laid down by dynamics related to consecutive events of concentrated flows, so debris flow, and runoff from the inner karstic system, alternating with episodes of éboulis accumulation, the dolomite coming from the wall, and the roof disintegration, and short phases of stabilization. Occasional events of deposition by surface, water current, currents, and tractic mechanisms are also detected. This implies that part of the collected assemblage can be in its original position, but that some objects may have suffered short distance displacement from the inner cave to its entrance. There are no major discontinuities within the succession, which seems to have accumulated within the same climatic and environmental context. Post-depositional processes include frostaction, especially visible in the lower part of unit 14 and in the whole unit 15, hydromorphism and weathering dynamics, and diagenesis that have selectively affected archaeological components. So the processes that determined the formation of the Ciota Ciara deposit are clearer now, but our results, in particular the occurrence of features related to frost action associated with new uranium-thorium dates that are now under review, suggest that the succession at Ciota Ciara entrance may be older than formally assumed and date to Middle Pleistocene. Then, as it happens most of the time during research, we started trying to answer to some questions, and we ended up facing new issues. In particular, first, the climate context, it is cold, as we've seen. So we are talking about a glacial conditions. Then why this discrepancy with microfaunal data that, according to published data, suggests a chronology for MIS-5 for this site? Second, the geoarchaeological data show differential weathering on archaeological finds and differential distribution on pedo features, so like it is related, for example, to the bone issues. Third, our data point to distinct inputs for the archaeological record, and part should be considered reworked. And finally, all this implies that some of the archaeological data should be reconsidered, and among them also the human remains, considering that there are not many sites that show human occupation in caves in this alpine sector during the Middle Pleistocene and Pleistocene itself. Reconsidering and revising the data that we have coming from Monte Fenera, but not only from here, could lead to reconsider also some of the human attribution that we have that have been made until now in this sector as well. Okay, sorry for the English, and thank you.